So welcome along, ladies and gentlemen, to your weekly SETI seminar series. Today we're very lucky to be joined by James Hartle, who's come up to us from Santa Barbara, where he's a research professor and emeritus professor at the Kavli Institute for Theoretical Physics. Jim did his BS at Princeton and then did a PhD at Caltech. His supervisor was Murray Gell-Mann, and his topic was complex angular momentum in three particle potential scattering. Wow. So he started off in particle physics, but then switched to gravitational physics, inspired at the time by, amongst other things, the discovery of quasars. He now likes to apply general relativity to questions of cosmology and astrophysics. He's therefore interested in gravitational waves, relativistic stars, black holes. He has also received the 2009 Einstein Prize from the American Physical Society. He was a co-discoverer of the Brill-Hartle geon, which was a state predicted by John Wheeler. While he was at University of Chicago, he developed the Hartle-Hawking wave function of the universe, which is a solution of the Wheeler-DeWitt equation, which marries quantum mechanics and gravitational physics. His current focus is on the quantum origin of the universe and the first moments after the Big Bangs, and that's what he's going to talk to us about today. So please join me in welcoming Jim.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, much outside my usual round, so to speak. Adrian said, I'm going to give you a talk on the quantum origin of the universe. And to begin, I'd just like to start off with a few statements about properties of the universe's view today. The basic building block, you can think of the universe, are galaxies, of which this is our Andromeda, our nearest large neighbor, which are collections of about 100 billion stars. And they're scattered throughout the universe in a fairly uniform way. So the universe is a universe of galaxies. And I think, for example, this picture from the Hubble Deep Field that was just recently released gives you a definite impression of that. And also how uniform the universe is. When you look over very large scales, it's much the same in one part of this picture as in any other. So there are roughly 100 billion galaxies in the part of the universe that we could see in principle, from light reaching us from the time of the Big Bang. And every 10 minutes, as the horizon expands, another galaxy with 100 billion stars comes across the horizon. In principle, we could hear from them as well. So a few key facts that will be useful to you. The universe is very large today. It's 14 gigaparsecs in the units astronomers use to keep the riffraff out. And I wouldn't guarantee that I converted it successfully to kilometers, but it's a very long number. And also, I think the only other thing you knew is the universe is smooth on very large scales, much the same in one place as in any other, much the same as in one direction in any other. There was a big revolution in our understanding of the universe in the 30s when it was discovered by combinations of people, Hubble, the Abbé Lemaître, and Vesto, Melvin, Slipher, that the universe was expanding. They supplied different pieces to this picture. And what they did was to measure the velocities of galaxies from the redshift of their spectral lines and the distance away from various standard candles like Cepheid variables, brightest stars, and so forth. And here you see a picture done not by, that's not Hubble's picture, but this is a recent modern version of what he did. Here's the velocity in kilometers per second of all these galaxies as measured by Cepheids here in supernova type 1A, which is the current favorite standard candle, versus distance. This is Wendy Friedman, who headed up this survey. And from this, you get Hubble's law, which says that the velocity of recession of the galaxies is linearly proportional to the distance they are away. That's useful. It tells us what's going to go on in the future. But it also tells us a lot about what went on in the past. If you run that expansion backward in time, then there comes to be a moment, approximately 13 billion years ago, when all the galaxies were on top of each other. Of course, they weren't on top of each other. And that's the Big Bang. The Big Bang was the beginning of the universe for all practical purposes, right? It's important to remember it's not some place in space that everything is rushing to. It occurs all over space at one moment of time. And at that time, on naive extrapolations, the universe was infinitely hot, infinitely dense, and infinitely opaque. Well, if the early universe was so hot, then it should be radiating. This was a prediction by Alpher and Hermann a long time ago, with somehow a picture of George Gamow in there. And that light, we should see that light today, cooled by the expansion of the universe. And it was first discovered by Penzias and Wilson, who detected it in 1966, and won the Nobel Prize for that important discovery. It's evidence for the Big Bang. You too, if you're old enough, might have detected it. Here's a picture of a television screen in the days before you got a blue screen when you tuned to an empty channel and you see lots of flicks. Well, 1% of that signal originates in light from the Big Bang. Of course, you didn't win a Nobel Prize for that, for watching TV. But we see it much better today, right, from satellites. This is a picture of the Planck satellite, which is the state of the art at the moment, the light from the Big Bang. This picture, if it was at the resolution of your eyes, would look completely uniform. The temperature is about 3 degrees, and these little red spots and blue spots are like one part in 10,000 deviations. So the early universe is seen at this time, which is really a picture 450,000 years after the Big Bang, approximately, is a picture of what it looked like. It's completely uniform, very simple, with these tiny fluctuations. Those tiny fluctuations are important, however, because they're what grew under the action of gravitational attraction to make the stars, planets, and galaxies that we see today. The Big Bang had an important intellectual consequence. It meant that the universe had a beginning. And that was a revolutionary idea for the time. All the great thinkers, starting with Aristotle, Copernicus, Kepler, Newton, and even Einstein, thought that it was static. After all, it didn't change very much. So in the 30s, we get this big revolution. But just a few years before that, there was another big revolution in physics, and that was quantum mechanics. Quantum mechanics started out as the framework for the physics on the frontier of the very small, the physics of atoms, molecules, protons, neutrons, elementary particles, string theory, et cetera. It's all essentially quantum mechanical. But at the beginning of the universe, as we've just saw, large and small are one. The universe is a smaller possible size. And therefore, quantum mechanics is important for the beginning of the universe, and therefore everything that happened since. And that's my talk today. It's on the union of quantum mechanics and cosmology, especially at the very beginning. Well, a characteristic feature of quantum mechanics is wave-particle duality. If you take an electron, right, and you send it through two slits, this of course is just a little schematic picture, then, just like light, you'll get interference between these two paths. That's the wave part of the duality. I just thought I'd show you a picture of a real video of a real two-slit experiment by these authors down at the bottom. And here it is. It'll take a minute. They sent electrons through their two slits, one every second, I think. So I hope you can see them gradually showing up on the screen, one after the other. These are all very, it looks, These are all particle-like, you would say. They speed up after a little bit, get tired, and there we go. But as you get more and more of them, eventually you see the electrons, right, acting as a wave, statistically, and reproducing this interference pattern over here. So I'll refer again and again to this, but it means that that's why in quantum mechanics, states of particles are described by wave functions. Functions, in the case of a particle of its position and time, and with that you can interfere these waves and get predict that interference pattern. But in quantum cosmology, we're interested in the question of if the universe is quantum mechanical, then it should have a wave function too. What is it? And what are its predictions? It's a necessary part of any final theory, or theory of everything, as it's sometimes known in physics today. Because if you don't have, in quantum mechanics, if you don't have a wave function, then you don't have any predictions at all from the theory, no probabilities. So this is the universe as a wave. So present final theories, or theories of everything, which are not theories of everything, as I'll explain, but have two parts. They have a theory of dynamics, with a Hamiltonian as some representation of it, which needn't concern us in great detail. Electrodynamics, string theory, something like that. And they have a theory of the wave function of the universe, like the no-boundary wave function, which I'll describe in a little bit. This, it seems to me, is probably an unfinished task of unification, but we won't need that for this talk. Quantum mechanics predicts probabilities for things. It doesn't predict what's going to happen. It predicts probabilities for you to bet on what's going to happen. And high probabilities mean you should win your bet. So if you throw a ball, according to Newtonian physics, if you knew the position and threw it with exact velocity, the trajectory would be determined. But in quantum mechanics, it could take any path, even one that went through the floor, classically forbidden. And it's only a matter of probabilities which ones it takes. In classical situations, right, the probabilities are high for classical deterministic behavior. But other than that, it's just probabilities. So a wave function of the universe predicts probabilities for not different trajectories of a ball, but for different histories of the universe and everything. It predicts, for example, probabilities for histories that started with the universe smooth and got lumpier, what was the probability that it had particular kinds of lumps, the probability that it will recollapse after many years, and so forth. Right? All the different possibilities for what it might do, right, are assigned probabilities by a wave function of the universe. Deterministic classical physics is an approximation of quantum mechanics, whose validity depends on the wave function. There isn't any certainty that the Earth will move around the Sun in a Keplerian orbit as it does, right? It's only a matter of that in the particular state that the wave function that the Earth has, that the probability is high for it to move in the Keplerian orbit and low for all the other orbits it might have taken. Well, as I said, a theory of everything is something that predicts quantum probabilities for everything. That's why it's called the theory of everything. But my teacher, Ray Gell-Mann, used to ask me, if you know the wave function of the universe, why aren't you rich? Good question, right? Particularly if it predicts probabilities for everything. Well, in principle, I think the wave function of the universe does predict probabilities for the New York Stock Exchange. Incredibly hard to compute, but we suspect if you did it, it would be, you'd get a probability of a half for it going up tomorrow and a half for it going down. Not useful information, right? Probabilities, it predicted a probability for everything like it was supposed to, but not useful probabilities for betting. And in fact, in some sense, that has to be true, because one of these fundamental laws of physics, we hope that they're simple, manageable, discoverable, and if it predicted all present complexity, like the number of people that came to this talk, it would probably be too complex to write down, certainly inconsistent with them. The combination makes predictions that are good for betting, but only for a few things. And the problem is to figure out what those things are. There are lots of things in nature, lots of regularities we see, like the regularities between different bird species. All of these have a bill, they all have feathers, they all have two wings, and so forth, but they're very different in detail. So the regularities that you have for birds probably don't, I'm pretty sure they don't. They don't arise from the wave function of the universe and the Hamiltonian, but from frozen quantum accidents, chance events that happened a long time ago and had a lot of influence in proliferating. Whatever it was, the biological biological accident or of mutation that started the bird species off, and they proliferated. Right. Most regularities that we see are of this kind. There are also things which probably do have interesting probabilities, like the SETI question. They would like to know, what is the probability there are more than 1,000 Earth-type planets that have intelligent life we communicate in the galaxy? That probably does have an interesting, not 50-50 answer, but it's incredibly hard to compute. We can predict the probability for galaxies. That's done. It's done by these massive computer simulations, like this example from the Millennium Project, where you take a lot of stuff, distribute it according to the quantum mechanical probabilities, let it rip, and then you get this large-scale structure. These knots, I think, are on scales much bigger than individual galaxies. They're clusters. Well, there you get the scale, 31.25 megaparsecs, right? It's 20 megaparsecs to the next biggest cluster, the Virgo cluster. Okay, so we could do that, right? And maybe we could do the probabilities of habitable planets, but probabilities of billion years of biological evolution, we're not going to do that anytime soon. So some questions presumably have interesting answers, but they're just too hard to compute. All right, enough about what it doesn't compute. What does it compute? In a rough approximation, you can separate the kinds of things. There's some things that depend, everything depends on both the combination of the dynamical theory and the state, you can separate, roughly speaking, there's some that depend more on the state than they do on the dynamics, and more on the dynamics than they do on the state. So on the Hamiltonian side, I've attempted to write down a list of them, we have for example, we hope that the theory predicts universal dynamical laws. The dynamical laws that apply to every single physical system without exception, without approximation, without qualification. And laboratory experiment, for example, CERN. As an example of a universal physical law, I offer the following, the universality of free fall. If you go up to the top of this building and you throw off a cannonball, a cat, and an economics textbook, they all fall to the ground with 9.8 meters per second squared, exactly the same acceleration, that's the university. That, of course, does not tell you very much about economics, cats, or cannonballs, for that matter. So it's a regularity that's predicted, but it's not very helpful. Now, before somebody puts their hand up to remind me that there is air resistance, I hear there are a lot of practical people in here, let me remind you about lunar laser ranging. The Apollo astronauts and Russian missions left on the surface of the moon beginning, I think, in 1969, corner reflectors. Here's a picture of a corner reflector. You get some that's probably Neil Armstrong's footprint or something like that. A corner reflector is just an arrangement of three mirrors coming in a vertex, like a vertex of a cube. And it has the property that if you send a light beam in, it bounces around and comes back exactly out. Since 69, right, people have been systematically sending laser beams to the moon. And they send out, I think it is 10 to the 8 photons, 10 times a second or something like that. And they get back one photon every few seconds, at least the earlier generation, like that. And therefore, from the time delay, you can measure the position of the moon to great accuracy, fractions of a centimeter. And the result is, you can trace the orbit, and the Earth and the moon are falling towards the sun with the same acceleration to a few parts in 10 to the 12. That's possibly the most accurately measured number in physics. So it's true. It's a universal law. And we believe it's the same. It's the same everywhere. So if we get messages from intelligent aliens on the subject of throwing stuff off the top of their buildings, we expect it to be boring. OK, well, that's dynamics. What about the other side? Now, that's what I'm really interested in. What does the psi predict? And I have a list of things. The fact that space-time is a classical, obeys the laws of general relativity, the universe was homogeneous. I'll just run through these very quickly and then come back to explain a few of them. The fact that we have inflation, it appears. The fluctuations away from these symmetries started in their ground state. The arrows of time, the fact we're all going downhill together. The CMB, large-scale structure, isolated systems, which we don't have in the early universe, the topology of space-time, whether it's we've got wormholes or not, number of large and small dimensions, and so forth. Big list. I propose just to tell you a little bit about how these explanations work. First, I'll just remind you, since this is very much concerned with what the space-times are, those are the histories of the universe, just a little bit of a general relativity. In Newtonian gravity, the Earth moves around the sun because it's attracted by the gravitational force exerted by the sun. In general relativity, a failure builds here up to, yeah, all right. In general relativity, the Earth doesn't move because it's attracted to the sun. It moves because it's going along the path of, in the straightest possible path it can, in the curved space-time that's produced by the sun. So the history of the universe is the history of its curved space-time and everything, of course, that's inside that. So now I want to describe to you a particular theory of the wave function of the universe. It's Hawking's no boundary quantum state of the universe. And in that, to have a theory, you just have to specify a wave function. The wave function is a function of geometries of space. And this particular wave function is given by a certain sum of e to the minus an action for the theory divided by h bar, right? And so you can calculate what it is. I'm not going to go into the details of what that means, but I try to give you a picture of what the space-times are that contribute to that sum. But there I'm faced with a fundamental pedagogical problem, which is that space-time is four dimension, one time dimension and three space dimensions. So you can't draw that on a two-dimensional piece of paper. So what I'm going to draw, in fact, is pictures like this, where these two dimensions are supposed to, in this surface, and you're supposed to think of that we're in the surface, and there's one dimension of time, and I'm only drawing one dimension of space. So slices of this space-time are moments in time. If you predict a particular time here, then you get space, and you can see that we're talking about a closed universe in this case. Because the space is closed. And if I put little dots on here and took three moments of time to represent galaxies, as time moves on, the separation of the galaxies gets larger and larger. That's Hubble's law. We've represented in a simple way an expanding universe. Now, general relativity, which is the theory of the classical theory of curved space-time, the one that tells us how the Earth moves in the curved space-time produced by the sun, predicts, if you extrapolate it backward, that the universe started in the Big Bang, all right. In fact, it's a little too much of a Big Bang. It started in what's called in physics a singularity. The density was infinite. The curvature was infinite. That's not too good from our point of view because it means you can't calculate anything. The no boundary idea was that the things that contribute to the sum are not like this. They're rounded off at the bottom. There's no boundary and then there's no singularity. You can't tell that now. So the things that go into the sum here are like that. No boundary, no singularity. This means that the notion of time actually breaks down at the beginning. Because it's not, you've got four dimensions all right, but it's not time and three space dimensions, it's four space dimensions down here, which make a transition, classically that would be forbidden, but quantum mechanically that's allowed, they give a kind of quantum tunneling from a quantum regime, right, to the classical regime where we have Einstein evolution. So there's no time here. People like to ask the question, what came before the Big Bang, since it was a moment of time, 13.7 billion years ago. In this picture, the question doesn't make any sense because the notion of time has collapsed. Going back, there's no meaning to four and four, they're just these four space dimensions. Now, I've drawn these pictures pretty symmetrically, nice smooth curves, but there can't actually be completely nice and spherically smooth like that. As you know, one of the facts in quantum mechanics, even in its lowest energy state, a particle will exhibit fluctuations. So for example, here's a particle rolling around in some bowl. Its lowest energy state would be at rest here in the bottom of the bowl. But you must have heard of the uncertainty principle that says you can't have a state where it's at rest and at one point. That's the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. So it solves this problem by, in the lowest energy state, exhibiting fluctuations, moving back and forth in effect. So it exhibits quantum fluctuations, if you like, before from the uncertainty principle. And those deviations from perfect smoothness mean that this thing has got a lot of little ripples, which I'm trying to represent here. And the uncertainty principle for finding fluctuations. And those little ripples, the little inhomogeneities in the picture, are what grew eventually to make the cosmic background radiation, the tiny fluctuations there that we see there, and eventually to picture of the large-scale structure we see today in the Hubble Deep Field. So roughly the history is as follows. We start out with a particular state. We calculate the quantum fluctuations in it. We have those grow to give small density fluctuations in the cosmic microwave background radiation. The growth, continued growth under gravitational attraction makes them collapse, right? And then you're into things like the Millennium simulation, you get stars and the galaxies that you see today. Now, at this point, right, if I was giving a physics talk, it would be time for the equations, exactly how you did that. Right? That's a kind of complicated story. So I'm just going to show you two things. The first is a word cloud, the abstract of one of our papers, this one right here. I think that will be just about as comprehensible as me launching into the equations. And secondly, I'll show you a picture of the authors, and for no good reason. Here we are in a place called working in a nature preserve in a place called Cooks Branch, Texas, thanks to the generous hospitality of Sheridan Lorenz and her family. We're sitting around there in the nature preserve worrying about the beginning of the universe. Nice work if you can get it, right, as the song says. Okay, well that's how the universe generates the fluctuations. I'd now, just to give a sample of what's going on, like to tell you about a few other things that it predicts. The universe exhibits arrows of time. There's the thermodynamic arrow, the increase in disorder measured by an appropriate entropy that goes on average over the whole universe. There's the radiation arrow, the fact, retardation, the fact that the light we get into our eyes now was emitted in the past and not in the future. The fluctuation arrow of time, the universe was smoother earlier and lumpier later. And the psychological arrow of time, we remember the distinction between we remember the past, experience the present, and predict the future. All those can be traced eventually to the fluctuation arrow of time. And that's what's explained by the no boundary wave function. So here is the explanation due to a lot of people. Remember this picture of the thing that contributed to the sun? Fluctuations are large up here, and they vanish from symmetry, basically, down at the bottom. The fact that the fluctuations are small at only one place, one of the places, at only one of our, this means the fluctuations are small at only one of the places where when the universe is small, it turns out. For example, if we had a bouncing universe, some of which are implied by this construction, the fluctuations increase away from the bounce on both sides. This means that the arrow of time also increases away from both sides from the bounce. That means, for example, if you were having, if there are people living back here where the universe is large, we have about as much chance of getting a signal from them as you have sending a signal backward in time to tell people not to vote for certain candidates. That isn't going to work. Okay, that's just one of the examples I just gave you. Another one, since we're at the SETI Institute, I thought I'd talk about a little bit is the fact that observers are important in making these predictions. So far, I've just said, well, what does the wave function predict? What kind of histories? What do they have? How smooth are they? Do they have a beginning? I haven't talked about recollapse or anything, but it's they're gross features. But it turns out observers are important in certain kinds of predictions. From the point of view of physics, we're physical systems. Within the universe, a sort of very special kind of fluctuation, but not essentially different. We have only a very small probability to exist, some complicated fluctuation in detail, in any one region of the universe. But probabilities for what we observe are conditioned on us being there to make the observations. For example, it doesn't make any sense to say, what does the wave function of the universe predict for the temperature of the microwave background, which is 3 degrees? Because the temperature changes in time, and you have to say, at what time did you make the measurement? Right? So that's a simple example of how this conditioning on the observable situation. In principle, you should continue conditioned on everything you know. We hope that, you know, the details of the temperature of the microwave background are not dependent on the number of people that came to this lecture. All right, so here's a problem for which that's important. It has to do with the cosmological constant. We don't actually know what the universe is made of, in case nobody has been here to tell you that, right? The 69% of it is made of what is properly known as dark energy, and what in physics appears to be well modeled by what's called the cosmological constant, which is a term that appears in Einstein's equations as he modified them at a certain step. The remaining 40% is divided into dark matter, which we also don't know what it is, and a few percent of protons and neutrons. Anyway. It's an important part of the universe and its evolution. Its measured value, its measured value is very small in the units that particle physicists like, Planck constant is set equal 1, the natural unit for measuring this, it's like 10 to the minus 120. And yet, it's going to play an important role in our future because it will make the universe accelerate. Here is a graph of, this is just solutions of Einstein equations, mass versus radius, roughly. And you can see here that we're about 14 billion years afterwards, right now. Things are turning over, but then roughly at our time, the amount of energy density in the matter is comparable to the energy density in the cosmological constant. But that's going to change because the universe is expanding. The energy density in the matter is going down, but the cosmological constant is hanging in there, right? And it's going to make the universe accelerate like that, faster and faster. We're lucky it doesn't have a bigger value, right? Because if it did, we wouldn't have everything that's going up into now. So you have to ask, why is it so small? Lucky for us. Well, there's a kind of explanation. First of all, in order to talk about it being small, you have to have a mechanism for it to vary. So one possible mechanism is there a class of theories called multiverse theories where the universe consists of a lot of bubbles. In each of those, the bubbles could, in principle, have different constants of nature, different theories, in fact, of nature. It could be that according to the wave function of the universe, if you applied it to that theory, that most of the bubbles have a cosmological constant with a reasonable value like 1. But we won't live there because we need galaxies. We'd have to form galaxies by the present age of 13.7. If lambda is too big, the accelerated expansion will just prevent anything from all those fluctuations from collapsing. The wave function of the universe predicts the probability of the values of lambda in that landscape of possibilities. And here's one calculation whose details I'm not going to describe to you. Here's the probability of lambda versus the value of the cosmological constant. And the no-boundary wave function predicts a peak like this, taking into account the galaxies and some other so-called anthropic constraints, not too many black holes and so forth, that it predicts a number which is roughly dead on. So the cosmological constant is about is the value of it that we see is more or less as big as it could be, right, and not mess with the formation of galaxies and structure, which is essential to our existence. Okay, well, that's just a few things. So here's some kind of scorecard for the no-boundary wave function. Does it predict classical space-time? Yes, it does. Right. I haven't gone into that very much, but I've sort of sketched it in pictures. Does it predict early homogeneity and isotropy and inflation? Well, I drew pictures of homogeneity and isotropy. We didn't discuss inflation too much, but yes, it predicts inflation. And the same conditioning is important in that. Fluctuations start in their ground state? Yes, it predicts that. Does it predict something about the arrows of time? Yes, it does. It's a CMB, the large-scale structure, yes. Isolated systems, you know, which aren't in the universe. Well, those happen very naturally from anything that's going to have collapse. Gravity waves from the early universe. Those of you who have looked at news recently may know about the BICEP experiment, where gravitational waves from the very early universe were detected, at least reported, for the first time. So like any other, it's just another kind of fluctuation, tensor fluctuations instead of scalar fluctuations. And so we predict that also, but not at the level that, assuming a certain type of string landscape, not at the level that BICEP observes. So there's a certain amount of controversy about, or things still to be pinned down about BICEP. And experimental things like the existence of foregrounds of dust, which also, because of magnetic field, dust particles could produce electric polarization. So the data is not yet in, but either that shows you this kind of thing is experimentally testable. Either this wave function is wrong, or the string theory landscape doesn't have this kind of property. Other things, numbers of large dimensions. Why do we have four dimensions? Well, you can sort of imagine doing that, but we haven't done it yet. So far, the no-boundary wave function seems to be a successful quantum theory of the wave function of the universe and the origin of our universe in a Big Bang. Okay, now I'd like to talk about the future, shift gears. Enough about the future. Enough past, what about the future? You all know, I think, that life on Earth is limited. It's about a third over in a few billion years. I haven't succeeded in getting a really clear number out of the astronomers, but the sun will become a red giant star. And there's some debate as to whether the Earth's orbit will be inside the star or outside the star. But either way, it's not good. Right? So that's the limitations on that. But if you wait a long time longer, 1,000 billion years, the stars will run out of fuel and they'll die. Then it gets colder and darker. Furthermore, in the far future, because of the cosmological constant, which is existence we're detecting, the universe will expand faster and faster, getting colder and colder faster. Space travel then will be pointless, because there won't be any other galaxies that could be reached, because they're all leaving because of the expansion and near the speed of light. And eventually, stars will die out. Run out of fuel, atoms will decay, black holes will evaporate, maybe the proton will decay, and matter as we know it will be vanish. It'll be cold, dark, empty, lonely, and simple. Also relevant to this SETI enterprise here, for the far future, it's going to be difficult to communicate if the universe expands faster and faster, we won't be able to get signals from other galaxies because that are in our past, because the light from them will be too redshifted, right, to be detected by reasonable means. Furthermore, we won't be able to send signals to other galaxies because they'll be moving away from us at close to the speed of light. I've been using the word we, but of course it's not going to be we. They'll be all alone in the local group of galaxies, which is a big gravitationally bound collection of about 30 galaxies. And if they weren't educated, they might not have even discovered cosmology at all. CMB will have been redshifted away long ago. It's the return of the back to the island universe theory. We won't be able to distinguish between that. Still, 30 galaxies is a lot to look for signals from. So the evolution of complexity, we're used to thinking of the universe as getting more and more messy. It started out very simple, homogeneous, isotropic, essentially in thermal equilibrium, and then those fluctuations grew. The middle universe is complex because we formed all this structure. Stars, galaxies. But the late universe is going to be simple again. No stars, no black holes, no light. They'll have evaporated. So complexity doesn't always have to grow. Now, life requires some complexity. Otherwise, what would be the point? If we lived in a completely homogeneous and isotropic universe, what would be the point of having a system? You want something that could exploit the inhomogeneities in the universe. Move to a better institute where they give you lunch. So there's a limited, of course, that's only 1,000 billion years, right? There's plenty of time not to worry about it. But anyway, it's interesting from the point of view of things to study here, I would think. Okay, well, that's basically my message, but I just want to end with a note of caution, right? extending quantum mechanics to the universe from the domain of the very small, from atoms, molecules, and so forth, that the whole thing is a big extrapolation. We have, as far as experiments go in quantum mechanics, they're improving and getting to larger and larger systems. The Zeilinger group, for example, can do two slit experiments with biological molecules, fluorofluorines, and this is and buckyballs and so forth. So they see the interference. This is for interference, I think, for these fluorofluorines right here, like that. You can see the famous two-slit experiment. Quantum mechanics works for quite large systems that are even, in a sense, macroscopic. But the biggest ones of like about 10 to the 8 particles, Joseph and Junch experiment. But still, it's a big cry, scale-wise, right, from extending it to the scales of the universe. So we haven't yet, right, done this kind of experiment, even. Right? And even worse, for the universe, there's no two-slit experiment. By definition, you can't interfere with anything. So why do we have quantum mechanics for it? OK, so far, so good. But we should think very carefully. I now like to just have two takeaway messages for you. The quantum origin of the universe may have a simple description in terms of a wave function. We may have even already discovered it, that describes some of its large-scale features, but doesn't predict everything. Most of what we see around us arose from the seeds of this quantum origin, the fluctuations, and the frozen quantum accidents that occurred in our past. Thank you very much.
If you have a question for Jim, just put up your hand and I'll get around to you. Jim, I have one question to start with. You mentioned that the wave function of the universe can tell us a little bit about the topology of the universe and you link that to wormholes. Can you expand on that a little bit more? Does it give us a figure of finding wormholes?
No, naturally? We're not close to that yet. That's, of course, why I didn't talk about it. But let's go back here to... This is good enough. I'm talking about the particular no-boundary wave function, right? So the wave function is given by this. It's e to the minus the action of some four geometry. Now, fluctuations and deviations, fluctuations cost action, therefore they reduce the probability. Big fluctuations like wormholes, right, would similarly cost action, and we believe reduce probabilities. So there has been some early work on the basic manifolds, right, for example, that can be done in simple cases. CP2. Right, not wormholes, but the complicated topology just of space on large scales. CP2, S2 cross S2, slices of the page metric. You may wonder what they are. You don't need to know. They were the low-hanging fruit where people had worked out solutions and we could calculate this in a semi-classical approximation. In that limited range of classes, it all favored the simplest possible. That is, the action was bigger for all those things than for the simplest possibility, which in a closed universe is the surface is a S3, a sphere.
I guess I'm having trouble understanding what it means to say the universe has a wave function. Clearly, it can't be represented mathematically in any finite way. If every elementary particle in the universe was a computer, you wouldn't have enough storage to represent it, and so on and so on. So what really does it mean to say that the universe has a wave function?
I don't think the storage issue is a problem. This is not much of a formula, but here it is, right? So you can represent this wave function in that way without a detailed accounting of every single particle, like this particle is in that state, that particle is in the other state. Then you calculate the predictions. So I don't think that's an obstacle. It might be other questions.
That's only a tiny tip of the iceberg of a full wave function. It only represents
Yeah, okay. So we've got to add in the other fields, right, what they are. But still, take a book on, you know, current contemporary particle physics, which string theory or something like that. Those books aren't that long, right? And if they write out effective Lagrangians, you know, sometimes they've got 100 terms in them. And that's supposed to give a complete description, right, as far as that goes. So we can calculate the probabilities of, so enumerating the possibilities, well, one issue I didn't talk on was coarse graining, right? As in everywhere in quantum mechanics and even for classical physics, you don't aim at some description at the level of the Planck scale, 10 to the minus 40, because we don't observe at that scale. So you use a description that's coarse grained, right? That's, say, down to a millimeter, or maybe, if we're doing accurate experiments, down to a much smaller size. So you integrate over all those ever things and then get prediction for the coarse grained predictions. No, I don't think that's a big problem.
Yes. In a diagram similar to this that you presented, down at the bottom of the cup, I believe I heard you say that there's no time dimension and there are four space dimensions. And then it goes through a quantum tunneling phase where it seems that one of the space dimensions gets converted to time.
Yeah.
Could you elaborate on that a bit?
Yeah. See, we don't have any blackboards here, so I can't expound. Are you familiar with things like the WKB approximation in quantum mechanics? Maybe not. There are lots of situations in quantum mechanics where you have, quantum mechanics is not classical. So only in some regions do you get classical behavior. And if you're evaluating a wave function semi-classically, which is sort of what this is, you find, for example, there's a possibility for us to tunnel through this floor, right? That tunneling description would be given by, if we dropped a ball here, the nice classical evolution of the ball. And then, in a certain approximation, it would be given by a complex path in complex time going through the ball, through the floor. And that agrees well with the experiment. So that is something similar is going on here. Something had to be concealed from you in order to give the lecture.
If we accept this theory of multiverse, in this case, there are two or even three questions.
Sorry, there?
If you accept a theory of multiverse, mm-hmm. So there are multiple bubbles, and we only live in one of them. So does it make sense to consider the wave function of the multiverse rather than just of one bubble? Or if you consider a wave function of our universe, can you assume that there is or can be some entanglement between these different wave functions of different bubbles? The last question is that if it so happens that we live in a bubble that is going to expand with acceleration indefinitely, can at some point happen some interaction between the different bubbles in this multiverse? So this is my
question. Well, you've asked a lot of interesting questions. As far as entanglement goes, right, it's very likely that it's entanglement because we have one pure state, which would represent all the bubbles. It's very unlikely to be a product of bubble states. So entanglement, yes. Yes, we can, it depends on what you mean. So the idea would certainly be to apply the wave function to the whole system, right, including the bubbles. And you can make little simple models of where that happens, right? And then typically you make a model, understand the nucleation of bubbles, then proceed classically. But also, as you're pointing out, you should have an effective density matrix or wave function or set of wave functions that apply in your own bubbles, and those could be calculated in principle. Not that much work has been done on this, so it's impossible to give you an answer, but I don't think there's any obstacle to doing that work. Just very messy and hard. Does that answer the question?
what about possible interaction between expanding?
Interactions between them?
Interaction between these expanding bubbles.
With the.
So if they're expanding, can they interact?
Yeah, that depends on the density of nucleation, right? But we hope people, you certainly can have bubble collisions. And those bubble collisions will produce an observable signature in the CMB, right? They're like little circles, and I think there are no candidates now, but they've been ruled out by better observations with Planck, but you know, people saw those some circles and certainly were addressing the issue of whether these circles could be the result of bubble collisions. That would be, the title of their paper was, I think, evidence for multi-universe, something like that.
Hi, over here. Behind the gentleman you were just talking to.
Right. Where? Oh, there we
Hi.
Go.
Hi. So on this diagram, there's something that strikes me as very strange, and it's actually not the equation. It's that you have no time on one side of this 10 to the negative 43 second, you know, circle. But then the question is, well, 10 to the minus 43 seconds counting from what, if there's no time there? Well, and I sort of, I guess, ties in with that question. If you just have space in the beginning of space-time, why is there a universe at all?
Small questions.
Well, as to why there's no universe at all, we assume in physics that there's a universe. Right, so we don't have any story like, because there's no physical representation of not having a universe. Right, we don't know what that is, right? So it's possible to speculate, I suppose. But this is something like a universe coming into existence from nothing. The trouble is that the discussion presumes the existence of time, to talk about the universe nucleating, which is exactly what is coming into existence along with everything else. Forget about the 10 to the minus 43 seconds. That's a rough idea of how big it would have to be when that phenomena occurred, right? This is all a semi-classical picture, right? So it would be roughly the seconds, of course, can be converted into meters, right? The distance from the bottom, let's say.
So you ended with the phrase frozen quantum accidents. Mm-hmm. But in the standard quantum story, you don't get a what I think you mean by frozen quantum accident, unless the wave function is externally observed, is measured at that point. So now the problem for the whole universe being a wave function is you don't have an outside observer. So where do you see these frozen quantum accidents fitting in, given that you're talking about the wave function of the whole universe?
Well, you see them in the histories, right? So you see a history comes along, and then in one history there's a mutation, right? And then pretty soon you get birds. So those are, maybe they're not, maybe the accidents could be alternatively described classically, or just the fluctuations. For example, the, let's not do that.
Well, it's the measurement problem. So what, if there's no outside observer, then it's all unitary evolution, the Schrodinger equation. Yeah. There's nothing to freeze. There's no way to pick out one.
It isn't the Schrodinger equation because we don't have a fixed notion of time, but you know, that's the Wheeler-DeWitt equation.
Okay, so sure. So, but what freezes one of the histories as being real?
Oh, right. We only calculate probabilities for what the real history would do.
I guess I could follow that up with this.
There's no, as you very well know from our right. There's no, we don't sort of single out one, there's no mechanism. We just calculate the probabilities. And then with that, we bet.
I believe that a gentleman called Everett was trying to make a wave function for the universe, and that, I think, leads to the proliferation of different histories and different possibilities.
This is very
so
much
I think
an
the question
Everett,
is which.
Yeah, an Everett sort of style. I didn't sort of go into the. I had a choice. I could concentrate on the data, or I could have given you a lecture on the interpretation of quantum mechanics.
Right? Okay. Also, just since I'm not familiar with these other things, you did have a Hamiltonian at one point. which generates evolution in time, then I assume that before 10 to the minus 43 seconds, some other mechanism occurs for changing things.
Yeah, people are just too, they just know too much here for this. H was just an idea for a dynamical theory. So what we would do in those situations is we would calculate by Feynman path integrals, right, for which Hamiltonian quantum mechanics is a limit, not in GR, right, but is a limit when there's a well-defined notion of time. Mm-hmm. Right, so when there's a coarse graining for which the geometry behaves classically, we recover something in Hamiltonian. But the Hamiltonian was only supposed to stand in for the action or superstring theory or something. Maybe I should have called it I.
I'm impressed by your by the fact that this theory predicts the cosmological constant, as small as it is. But I have one other question. You said that the gravity wave, primordial gravity wave prediction is short of the recent BICEP discovery. How much short of the 0.2 value?
We get close to zero.
You mean several orders of magnitude below the discovery?
Yeah, but don't forget the predictions are contingent on the landscape. Thomas Hertag, who did these, took as a model of the landscape the set of potentials that were actually used by Planck to reduce the data. That's not much of a landscape, but it illustrates in that framework. So, for example, maybe if there are no potentials with low plateaus, right, then it would boost it up. So there are two sources of uncertainty, not just the state, but also the landscape. Did that help? You looked assertive.
So you introduced the no boundary wave function to remotivate it by solving the Big Bang singularity problem, but then later you discussed these internal inflationary models that produce these bubble universes. It seems like in that framework of eternal inflation, you don't have the singularity issue in the first place. So what's the relation of the no boundary wave function to eternal inflation?
We don't. It's true that it's difficult to see if the attractor sort of stuff in internal inflation is true, right? It would erase dependence on initial conditions if they were in a fixed spacetime. We have to predict the spacetime as well. So the motivation, I think, was more that we should, I did allude to connect this with the singularity. It wasn't so much to solve the singularity problem, it's just to find a natural example. In some sense, this is the wave function that more closely approximates the ground state wave function in a closed cosmology. You're used to thinking of a ground state wave function as the lowest eigenvalue of some Hamiltonian, or maybe you're not, I'm not sure, okay. But there are two ways of calculating a wave function. One is, ground state. One is if you have a Hamiltonian. One is the lowest eigenstate, and the other is by a certain Euclidean path integral. The Euclidean path integral exists for gravity of closed cosmologies, the ground state. So it's the simplest possible wave function. That's really, I think, the motivation. It also removes the singularity.
Last question. Yeah, is there a role for information in this model? Trivial example would be if you go back to New York Times example and you predict the wave function for the stock exchange tomorrow, if everybody knew about that, trust me, that would change the probabilities dramatically as compared to no one knowing about
it. I'm not worried about that problem.
No, but it still carries on into the...
Right. There is a role for information. For example, let's see if I can get back to it. Where are we? Oops, going the wrong way. Anyway, I had that slide with the evolution of complexity in the universe. What do we mean by complexity? Right, exactly. That's itself a hard problem. And so some variants of, for example, the algorithmic information content, right, of the coarse graining that describes those, right, would be one measure of complexity to look at. Then the question is, they aren't required, like entropy, to go up, which is another information theoretic measure. So there's plenty of room for speculation in this, but not much done yet.
All right. If you have any more questions, I encourage you to come up afterwards and speak to Jim. Address them straight to him. Jim, we have a special SETI Talks mug there. It has a couple of robots. Unfortunately, this does have a boundary, as you can see.
I don't know. It's pretty. It looks to me like a
fine bottle,
and it's got another handle, right, on it. It's a wormhole, and this is suppressed.
That sounds like a good description. Please join me.
All right. Good. Oh, yeah. Well, I finished on time.